Oba. Baba.
I'm going to break the face because of the weather. Right, that was great.
Oh, I can say what? Can you always say? How good?
Should we wait for the cookies? They're saying they're crossing live and they are in the studios are waiting for a way because they are live. So I'll just check.
Patrick, check on your Patrick.
Ah, Rati.
So I'm a political office. Since I'm going to say over there. Thanks, bro. Yeah, it looks a brand record.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to this press conference. I apologize for the late start and for the delay in issuing the statement, which is on its way. We should have it after a few minutes. This is a press conference to report on the Central Executive Committee, which took place on Monday, Tuesday and Wednesday this week. And on the top table we have, starting at the far end, First Deputy President Jojo James, Second Deputy President Zingis Barosu, President Steve Ojomini, Deputy General Secretary Becky Chalichali. Becky and Chalichali will read out a prepared statement and then it will be open for you to ask questions.
Silver.
Thanks, Comrade Pat, and good morning. Let me read the COSATU statement of the CEC. The Congress of South African Trade Unions held a normal CEC of its Central Executive Committee from the 2nd to the 4th March 2015, attended by the national office bearers, affiliated unions, and provincial structures. The CEC took place within an international context in which the country is focusing on a campaign on Israel Apartheid Week. There's a deepening repression, unemployment, and exploitation of workers all over the world. There are recent developments regarding the Cuba-US diplomatic relations, in which we saw the release of the remaining Cuban political prisoners and the process towards the restoration of a diplomatic relations. On the home front, we have just received the State of the Nation Address, which attempted to respond to the crisis of unemployment, inequality, and the energy crisis engulfing our country. We have just received the mortal remains of two great heroes and the leading architects of our revolution, Comrade Moses Gordhan and J.P. Marx. As we confront the challenges of the Federation, we remain inspired by these two leaders of our revolution who never shirked their responsibility and who, despite all odds, were able to construct the trade union movement, the SACP and the ANC, and the liberation movement as a whole into an oasis of hope and bulwark for liberation of our people. We will follow in their footsteps. The debate and discussion in the CEC were characterized by the commitment to assert the supremacy of COSATU over individual leaders and to achieve the unity based on the founding principle and traditions of the Federation. Unity and organization for workers is everything to us. It was in this context that the CEC expresses determination to continue to rebuild and strengthen the unity and cohesion of the Federation. The CEC noted that the Federation was under attack from those who had an intention to weaken COSATU, destroy it, and if all fails, use to pursue their political agenda. It was in this context that all affiliates present in the CEC made a stern resolve to defend the unity of the Federation. On achieving unity and cohesion through visible campaign and unity in action, the CEC agreed that while it's important to continue engaging in a political process which is aimed at achieving unity and cohesion, it is clear that such unity will not be achieved through boardroom meetings alone. The unity of COSATU will always be forged in the streets through campaign focusing on issues which are affecting workers and the working class in general. The meeting therefore agreed that a meeting of the organizing and the campaigns committees to convene urgently to decide on the program to roll out campaigns including the following: a campaign against racism in the workplace, the COSATU socio-economic demands, against the ETOLs, against the labor brokers, solidarity with workers, including in the public sector wage negotiations, and other workers in the post office, telecom, etc., who are engaged in their struggles. Engaging the National Treasury on a comprehensive social security and tax reform, particularly in the sport and the entertainment sector. The CEC received a moving presentation by the Football Players Union, which argued that workers in the entertainment sectors, such as the football players, those in other sports codes, and artists, were being subjected to unfair tax regime, and yet their conditions of work were not similar to ordinary workers who had secure jobs and relatively sound benefits. We will be requesting a meeting with a cluster of ministers, which include the Minister of Sports and Arts and Culture, Social Development Minister, and the National Treasurer, to discuss social security measures and a new tax regime as part of the measures aimed at addressing the plight of the workers in the entertainment sector. These will include a call to discuss modalities to have part of the gate collection fees during the soccer games and entertainment events being used to contribute towards worker pension fund. We'll also take up a campaign against the agents in these sectors. On the freedom of association and the protection of the right to organize, 1948, Convention 1987, in relation to the strike, the CC received a report that the right to strike was under attack, not just in South Africa, but all over the world. Attempts were being made by employers' groups at the ILO to argue that although the right to strike is recognized in the Constitution and all regulated in the labor legislation of many countries, International Labor Convention, including Convention Number 87, do not contain any express provision for the right to strike. We'll be lobbying our own government and relevant ministers to raise this matter sharply at the ILO, and if our plea is ignored, we'll work with other international federations to take the matter to the International Court of Justice in accordance with the ILO Constitution Article 937, which provides that in an event of a dispute over interpretation of the Constitution, the governing body of the ILO can refer one or more of these issues to the ICJ. We had a labor conference in 2014 in which we adopted the declaration, which included the commencement of the process toward the national minimum wage. A task team of principals constituted by the COSATU NOPs and technical task team has been constituted. The terms of reference were adopted by the meeting of NEDLEC, the committee of principals held on the 21st February 2015. In the next CEC, we'll be working on finalizing the actual monetary figures for a national minimum wage. The CEC agreed that COSATU affiliates will also work with the CCMA to provide a nationwide training on the recent labor laws amendment. This includes the Employment Equity Act, the Labor Relations Act, the Basic Condition of Employment Act. This will also clarify the role of the CCMA as it has to play the implementation of this amendment. This work will be coordinated from COSATU office, working with relevant union-designated leadership. The next special CEC will finalize the dates for the actual action. On the remaining challenges on unity and cohesion, the CEC appreciated that some unions which have raised concern regarding the expulsion of NUMSA and the convening of the Special National Congress did attend the CEC. These unions know that the only way of raising their issue is within the constitutional structures of the Federation. This is a demonstration of leadership and discipline founded on the principle of our movement. The meeting condemned the decision of certain other affiliates to boycott the CEC meeting. The CEC was clear that COSATU has no structures which can exist parallel or outside of the constitutional structures of the Federation and expected to be accorded constitutional recognition. We call on these affiliates to return to future meetings to engage in a democratic process where all union are treated as equals, and where all views are given equal weight and get subjected to the same democratic scrutiny before any decision is taken. The views of this union can only be respected when they are raised inside the Federation rather than in the media and outside the structures of the Federation. We call on all members of these unions to call on their leadership to come back to their real home, COSATU. On the conduct of the COSATU General Secretary in the CEC, the meeting expressed deep concern against the General Secretary of the Federation, who continues to conduct himself in a manner that sought to define him either above the organization or to act outside the discipline of the collective leadership. He has not attended 3 meetings, including the CEC, at which he was expected to play his leadership role. It is the General Secretary who has written a notice convening the CEC as part of his duties to do so. It was therefore difficult for the CEC to understand why the same person will announce in the social media that he will not attend the CEC, which is his duty to prepare for, attend and participate in shaping the outcome of its democratic processes, particularly given that he is aware of an agreed ANC-facilitated political process towards achieving unity and cohesion in the Federation in which all affiliates are participating. It was agreed that the General Secretary must be afforded a chance in a special CEC, which will be convened soon, to have him to come and explain his conduct. On the Sizwe Nzaluba Koboto forensic report, the CEC received a report from the Sizwe Nzaluba Koboto firm of auditors. They were commissioned by the CEC to conduct a forensic investigation into alleged impropriety in the sale of the COSATU head office and the purchase and ownership of the new COSATU. They were also requested to conduct a forensic investigation into a manner in which FSB report was handled by Kopano Kimatla and into the allegation involving comrades Vavi step doctor in the VMS, one of the service providers to COSATU. Such report was concluded and handed over to COSATU, and the CEC found that the report did not cover all aspects instructed the Sizwe Nzaluba Koboto to investigate the processes following terminating contracts with various service provider and the process followed in awarding the contract to VMS. On among other things, the report implicated the General Secretary. It also showed that the auditors had not been able to meet with him despite all attempts they have made to secure a meeting with him. The meeting mandated the NOPs to write a letter to the General Secretary to meet with the auditors to provide any information which may be required. The special CC will receive the final report and make a determination on the way forward based on the recommendation in the report. Building COSATU, ratification of the elected provincial leaders. The CEC ratify the election or the by-election of all the provincial leaders elected in the Free State, Northern, Northwest, KZN, and Limpopo. On the Eastern Cape, the CEC reprimanded the Eastern Cape leadership for their tendency of making pronouncement to oppose and undermine the decision of the Federation, including the decision of the 7th November 2014 Central Executive Committee meeting. The comrade explained the reason for their conduct, but the explanation was not accepted by the CEC. The meeting was emphatic that the CEC is the highest decision-making organ of the Federation in between the Congresses, and no COSATU structure had the right to oppose or undermine the decision taken by the CEC. Provinces were there to implement the decision taken by the senior structures of the Federation. They had no powers to say to change such decisions. The forthcoming special CEC will receive a report from the task team which has been tasked to work on the challenges confronting the Eastern Cape province. On the national congresses, the CEC confirmed that a special national congress will take place in July 2015. A special CEC will be convened soon to consider how best the dates, or the special CC will be convened soon to consider how best the dates of the Special National Congress and the Ordinary Congress can be properly sequenced. On the litigation against COSATU, despite the President have conceded to the Special National Congress, the Federation was served with court papers. Our lawyers inform us that the applicants are prepared not to continue with the litigation if we issue the notice. And we have committed that we shall issue a notice in line with the COSATU Constitution. On the litigation on appeal by NUMSA, we have been served with court papers under Rule 53, which we have successfully contested, and NUMSA has now been instructed to amend its motion, which they've agreed to do so. On the application for affiliation, COSATU confirmed that it is a home of all workers and that all are invited to be part of COSATU under the founding principle of one union, one industry. And workers that are not affiliated to COSATU are recognized as not organized. COSATU union must continue to provide quality services to workers, which has always been the hallmark of COSATU union. The CEC discussed two applications as follows. The one on the South African Emergency Personnel Union, it was noted that the scope of this union overlaps in the sectors in which Nihau and some organize workers. So it was agreed to convene a meeting between the three unions to discuss the issues concerning their scope in line with the COSATU founding principle of one union, one industry. This meeting will report back to the special CEC for a decision on whether or not to accept the application. On the Liberated Metal Union of South Africa, the meeting was satisfied that the union application meet all the constitutional requirements in line with Clause 2.1 of the COSATU Constitution. It was, however, agreed to allow two unions to seek mandate from their structures on whether to accept or reject the application. A final decision will be taken at the special CC, which will be convened soon. On the programs and budget, the meeting received a report on the prioritized programs for 2015. This was viewed against the report regarding the Federation States of Finance. The programs and the budgets were adopted. Regarding the Post-Alliance Summit task team, the meeting was concerned that the task team, which was established at the 2013 Alliance Summit to discuss concerns raised by the party and COSATU, has not been able to deliver in its mandate. It was supposed to discuss the important issues, including the economic policy, the NDP, the labor law amendment, and the employee share ownership scheme. The CC agreed to reconstitute the COSATU team to this alliance task team. This will be done as part of the process to overhaul all COSATU representatives into various committees and to ensure effective planning, accountability, and mandate-seeking processes. On the COSATU and the party bilaterals, the meeting received a report on the bilateral meetings between the Federation and the SACP in 2014. The meeting agreed that the Federation has to take forward its decision to support and strengthen the SACP, including through to availabilities of resources, the Deputy General Secretaries of the two formation will meet to finalize outstanding administrative issues. The SACP and COSAT Organizing Department will meet to finalize the development of the joint campaign focusing on the SABC, ensuring the realization of the radical second phase of our transition, the NHI, retirement and pension fund, comprehensive social security, racism in the society and the workplace, organization building activities such as a joint recruitment program and supporting union in various sectors, etc. On the 8th January statement and the ANC Lekhutla, the meeting received a report on the ANC Lekhutla and agreed that we need to find better ways to engage in such a gathering in order to have a bigger impact. It was not acceptable that COSATU views are sidelined at Lekhutla and yet it is announced that the Federation were present, implying our endorsement of the conclusion. There was also a concern at the number of business representatives attending the meeting. On the international solidarity, one on Swaziland, the president of PUDEMO, Comrade Mario Masuku, continues to languish in the jails of the Swaziland under the merciless monarchy of King Muswati. It has been reported that the president of PUDEMO is currently sick. COSATU NOPs will soon be visiting the comrade in Swaziland prison cells. We call on all South African and the freedom-loving people of our country to raise their voices against the Mswati monarchy and call for the release of political prisoners, including Comrade Mario Masuku. We specially call on all South Africans or our South African government to move speedily to provide medical care for the president of PUDEMO. This may include asking that he be moved to South African military hospital to receive care from healthcare facilities meant for the heads of state. Lastly, on the apartheid week, on the apartheid Israel week, COSATU will be joining millions of South African freedom-loving people in solidarity with the people of Palestine. We call on our unions to intensify our campaign against the apartheid Israel. And COSATU will never rest until the people of Palestine enjoy a complete freedom in their motherland.
That's six answers.
Thank you very much, Becky. I will now throw the meeting open for questions. Can I just remind you, when you speak, press two buttons in front of you, one on the speaker and the little one on the table in front of it. You as well as speaking.
As usual, we'll go for
groups of three. apologies if I can't see some of you because there are so many TV cameras. I'll do my best. I see one, two. I'm not usually this shy. Yes, there's a number three. Right. Number one.
Sure, play ANSL TV. There has been talk by the unions that they did not participate of a possible alternative federation being formed. Does this concern this federation? And also, it seems clear that quite a bit of time was spent discussing in the CEC Secretary General's absence and the absence of other units. The SG has said that COSATU is so busy with internal frictions and rustling that they haven't been able to work at things like against labor brokering, unemployment, poverty. Is this the case?
Hi, Amy Musgrave, Independent Newspapers. I've got a couple of questions, please. And it's around the money issues. Firstly, I've seen the budget, I've taken it with the budget that was presented to the CEC from a finance committee, and according to my calculations, COSATU is at a deficit of over 14 million rand for this year, and that's without the possibility of two congresses, which are probably going to cost around 7 million rand each. So I'd just like to know in that regard, if these numbers are correct, and if they are correct, surely the argument that COSATU is not broke is incorrect, unless you have money elsewhere that we don't know about. And then just on the recommendations on your cost cutting and things like that, I see one of the, obviously it's still a recommendation, was that COSATU cuts its policy unit. I mean, surely this is going to be a problem considering what you're up against every day. And then, just lastly, besides your freezing of posts and cutting down like on telephone bills and things like that, are you looking anywhere else to find money?
Hi, Yana Lana from Bill Newspaper. You're criticizing the seven unions for not raising the objections within the structures, within the constitutional structures, but the same unions have asked you more than 18 months ago to call the Special National Congress, which you are obliged to hold within the very same constitution that you are criticizing. And how should they mention their participate in constitutional structures that is actually being taught by yourselves? And secondly, I'd like to know which unions were objected to, wanted to consult their structures about the Lemosas affiliation. And do you have a date for the special CEC where you will decide on the special national congress and on
Thanks very much. Who would like to respond?
Thank you very much, and good day to everybody present. Let me start by making just a short general comment. Each time we are going to have a CEC or a very important meeting of COSATU, there shall be, or there is always a parallel or prior media briefing just to deflect attention to the agenda of the CEC meeting of COSATU, so that we all are then driven to speak about other issues other than those that we are supposed to discuss here. And I know for a fact that some amongst yourself were given such a briefing on and off the record. So I will not ask whether that question comes from the off the record or it's a question that you genuinely are asking. It's fine. I will give responses to the questions in the best of my capability. The first question was talking about an alternative federation. I want to indicate that we have been aware of this work for quite a time now. Actually, it's been work that has been going on for over a period of 2 years. Fortunately, there is still some very principled people outside there who refuse to participate in an agenda to destroy COSATU. And indeed, gradually they have been turning them down and say we shall not be party to an agenda to weaken and divide labor in South Africa. And we appreciate those federations that have indeed taken that principled stance. We know that openly people have said the mission is to reclaim COSATU from a right-wing clique. If all fails, then work to form a new federation will unfold. So it's not a new thing, but what we can tell you in the context of the South African labor politics, with the standard that has been set since the advent of our democracy, anything, any new federation that gets formed after COSATU fails, go to history. There has been an attempt to form one. I won't name the name because really they have nothing against us, but they remain just an attempt to form a new federation. So the program and the agenda of such, even if you give it red robes to wear, it remains an attempt to form an alternative to COSATU, whilst COSATU will be COSATU. We are determined. We are on a path to ensure that we strengthen this organization. They have tried, they won't stop. They will come even within to try to weaken within its own systems. We are aware and we are dealing with those challenges. The second question raised by the same colleague about the non-participation of the unions, because let's correct it for the world to know, because journalists can't count. You see, COSATU at the moment has 17 unions. There are 17. In the CEC that we held, there was 12 unions participating. 17 minus 12 is 5. So stop the fallacy of 8. 5 is very important for COSATU. We want them back here. They should come back, engage internally, state their views. You don't build unity from outside the platform where unity engagements are happening. So we love them. We want them inside because that's where they belong. The CEC was very emphatic. The statement has just said it. And therefore we are worried. I can't overemphasize the fact that even our General Secretary indeed could not be with us. And the CEC has indeed against your wishes and predictions and other people's wishes, we are steady. We don't want to rush in building, because if you rush in building an organization, the mortar may not be well cooked. We are a COSATU that has got to ensure that every brick and mortar put together is going to stick together for the next 30 years of COSATU. So you're not gonna be rushing according to the whims of outside people who say because the general secretary of COSATU didn't attend or defied this CEC, this is what is going to happen. We are steady, we're doing our work, we are confident in building this organization in spite of the push factors from outside and internally. I will leave the next questions, and which is very, very critical, because from the off-the-record briefing, you guys have been given documentation, not Emmy. you have been given documentation of how worse or how bad are the finances of COSATU are, and you have been informed that they are so bad because COSATU has expelled NUMSA, and therefore it is very difficult. The other side of the story that you may not have been informed is how much, to prove that point, work has been happening inside COSATU to ensure that it is weakened, it is stripped, it is non-functional from within, particularly to achieve that point. And it has always been continuously defeated. We have presented a budget, obviously, given those circumstances. It's a budget informed by those realities, because COSATU depends on its union subscriptions. If unions pull back on their subscriptions because they are aggrieved of the expulsion of another union, we have to adjust our and adapt our budget accordingly. That in correct mathematics is not equal to you are in this situation because then NUMSA has been expelled. NUMSA was very, very important for COSATU, like all the unions of COSATU. But it is not true that you will say COSATU therefore is in a financial crisis because it has expelled NUMSA, or because the money that was coming from NUMSA has been stopped. By the way, we have been in the same situation we have been for a long time. The final analysis will tell you that we are finding ourselves in this situation because of wrong decisions that have been taken before, because of contracts that have been reached before, not following due processes, because of unchecked decisions that have been taken. When you sell or purchase a building, then you are finding yourself in this particular situation, which is why COSATU cannot ignore those areas. I know everybody expects us to ignore and say no, we can ignore this and move forward. How do you move forward when you are financially drained because of a wrong decision that would have been taken? Let me just stop there and allow comrades to deal with the rest.
Thanks, Comrade President. Let me just indicate that it is not true that COSATU spent all of its time to discuss the issue of the internal conflict. You look, there's a COSATU constitution that normally says you may discuss the matter not more than 1 hour unless by agreement you extend. So there is an intention in COSATU to discuss all the items on the agenda. In this CEC, we got over 40 items, not easy items, very difficult items. But those might have seen the agenda. It's a big, big, big agenda. And we discuss and conclude that particular agenda. All the times we discuss unity, we discuss politics, but we'll balance politics with the organizational section as well as with the socio-economic section. So it's not true. Of course, it affects your participation and your engagement if there are issues that divide us, divide you. It will have an impact. There's no doubt about those particular issues. It would make the meeting to be very tense. But we discuss all issues because, as we said in our statement, you don't build unity over abstract discussions. It has to be seen in the program. It has to be seen in working together. But just to emphasize what the president was saying, the role COSATU plays in the labor movement is recognized by those other federations that it competes with. Let me make for an example. There is a new structure on the BRICS trade unions. The federations appointed COSATU to be their representative. They, on their own, and they tell us when we meet, that the division in COSATU worries them. And they want COSATU to be united so that it can be able to lead them. In the International Labour Organization, this federation has appointed a COSATU representative to represent all of them. In the ITUC executive, which all these unions are affiliated, they are represented by COSATU. In NEDLAC, the overall convener in NEDLAC, appointed by this federation, is from COSATU. In the public sector wage negotiations, the chief negotiator is from COSATU. I mean, the list is endless. That's why they compete together, but they need COSATU to be able to provide leadership in terms of all those particulars. So while we compete, but there is a recognition that COSATU has to deal with. Dilang, on the Special National Congress, your question was why these unions who are outside should continue participating here when they are being ignored. Now, this union participated on their call for a Special National Congress. They didn't walk out. But when the president announced that there is a date for a National Special Congress, they opted that the following meetings they will not attend. Clearly indicate that their participation and their continuing pushing for a Special National Congress was achieved by their participation and being consistent in arguing as to why the president should participate in this issue. It just make us not to comprehend as to how do you influence people when you are outside. How can you argue with some people when you cannot change views inside the meeting? That's why, in our view, we commended those other union who says we have a different views here, but we are going to be part of this meeting. So the Special National Congress is in July 2015. We repeat this now, I don't know for how many times. It's July 2015. The union who asked for this Special National Congress knows this. Their legal representatives on this matter, they appreciate these things. They just say, issue a notice. And we said, we'll issue a notice in terms of the COSATU Constitution. On the budget, the funding model of COSATU has been debated for over time, including from the time that COSATU unions agreed to establish investment company. One of their reasons to go to this difficult terrain was an appreciation that you cannot fund your programs from your subscription only. So it has been a challenge all the time, from the time the Federation took a decision that very small unions, when they were talking about the super union and cartels, is that it is not sustainable to stand alone and be able to drive your program in terms of this particular. So it has been an issue that has been debated for a very long time in COSATU. The difficulties that the Federation has, though, has been that when the investment company has been set it up, this mandate of funding the Federation has been put aside in pursuit of profit. So in coming to this meeting, I mean, if you look to the other three past audited financial statement of COSATU, you'll see the deficit. COSATU has been not worried about the deficit. It's not an organization for profit. It's an organization that its budget is based on break-even. You get money because you must spend it. You are not getting money to put and build reserve. It was not made of profit, is to carry its mandate. Now, when we ask for the budget or the income adjustment, we raise the issues of the 6%. Because normally we'll find it difficult for unions to get an increase above that particular. And union has been saying, what we pass to COSATU, we must get it from our members. If we don't get an increase from our members, we can't give increase to COSATU in terms of subscription. And their argument is that under the difficult economic conditions, we are not likely to get an increase above the inflation. So in that context, we put the 6% and said we want 6% to adjust. But there's a longer debate that COSATU need to engage on is the viability and the sustainability of the Federation. The union debated these issues. The union says, no, gives them 16%, 10%, but everyone says, we don't believe that even if we can give 16%, we're going to be addressing the long-term funding of the Federation. And then they said for the first time, want the meeting of the general secretaries immediately to sit down and look for a long-term funding model for the Federation, including the role that the investment companies of the unions have. They said it's unacceptable that you can have a COSATU that is financially challenged when other unions are making millions in profit. They said it doesn't work that way. They need to sit down and work a long-term issue, which we appreciated. Mm-hmm. We're convening a meeting next week for this general secretary. They said, give it to us. Don't even give it to treasurers. Treasurers will look in terms of the books. Give it to a political leadership to solve this issue. So we're positive that we're going to be dealing with these issues. The issue of cutting, I haven't seen any organization that does not look to cutting every time. It's like yourself when you are dealing with your own family budget. What do? You look to the balances, you look at how best you can be able to use your resources, and you cannot do above what you don't have. It is true that in the budget we have, that's why the General Secretary says we need it to meet. The deficit in the 6%, in the scenario those that might have received, is a 5 million deficit, excluding the Congresses, because the Congresses are once off. In the history of the Federation, we never budget Congresses in the affiliation. We fundraise for the Congresses because it's a once-off thing, and it just passed by in relation to those particular. So we are comfortable what we have, and we think we'll be able to move forward. This is a short year in terms of COSATU. We're going to be moving for May Day. We're going to be having congresses in the provinces, and there are numbers of unions that will be also having their congresses. And then we move to the National Congress, and the year is almost gone. So the cutting has been an issue that is going on in COSATU that needed to be monitored, because
the FinComs of the unions and the federation as a whole is based on the principle that you can't spend what you don't have. And I think it's a principle for any other organization. You can't spend what you don't have.
Thanks for DGS. Really, most questions have been responded to. But I want to probably request yourself to help us to understand, or at least myself, when you are saying, coming from ANCA, that the General Secretary said COSATU is busy with internal fights other than worker issues, I would have so that perhaps we can once and for all satisfy ourselves, what are these internal fights? Did he explain, did he really say what are the internal fights that COSATU is busy with? Because I think at this time we need to respond to things as they are, and they must be called by names, so that when they come here, they don't take a different shape and we respond to things that we don't know. Because something is so impregnated that you may think you are responding to this, but a question responds to a different thing that was asked. And I think it would be better for us, as National Office Bearers of COSATU, to get to understand exactly what are these internal fights. Maybe it will also be for your own benefit that we may be able to explain to you. Because if you look at the press statement that was just read, it does not talk to any battles here internally. It talks to progress that is made on worker issues. Now, what are these internal fights? And I'm posing that question back so that we don't respond to things that are round and yet they take a different shape when we're outside. I think it would be best for us and for COSATU to respond to things as they are. They must be called by name. Thanks.
Next round.
Next round, that is number one. Number two. And anyone who hasn't spoken already? No? Well, second bite then for number three.
Claudie. Okay, thank you. Claudie from eNCA. I also have just one or two questions. Regarding the Sizwe Ntsaluba Kobodo investigations, it's now been 2 years that they have been investigating the alleged financial impropriety, especially against Zwelithuba. Now you're saying that in this statement that they have not covered, you've discovered that they not have not covered all aspects. What other aspects are still outstanding? What remains outside? And again, I don't think the question that was asked by a colleague previously, that the unions that are supposedly asking their members or seeking a mandate from their members on Limusa's acceptance or rejection. I don't remember that being answered, correct me if I'm wrong. So that's a question. And last two, do you share Vavi's view that if Limusa is accepted into COSATU, this will effectively be the split of COSATU? And if you don't share those views, will you tell us why? And by the way, they did make a presentation in the CEC, we understand. Where do they say they are going to be organizing? Because the understanding is that they are metal workers. So will they effectively replace NUMSA if accepted or such? And again, I'm going to have to press you on a specific date, please, on the special national congress. We know it's in July, but is there a particular date? Thank you.
The reason that we gave President last year not to convene the special congress was financial constraints. And now you say that you will have the special conference in June, And I know that COSATU will have its congress again in September. So, what is pressing you now to have the special congress while the normal congress is in September? And this is what we have been arguing to say, but why should we rush into the special congress while the 2015 congress is around the corner? But also, I want to know if you have considered cutting on the political level, and would this mean that you might not be able to assist the ANC next year in local government elections? And you saying that you find yourself in this situation because of some of the decisions taken, for example, the purchasing of the building, you seem to be blaming one person for that, which is Vedin's mother. Was this decision not to purchase the new building not taken by the entire leadership? Why did you see at that time that if we enter into this deal, you'll end up in the present situation? Lastly, I just wanted to check the issue of the credit card. What happened is that did the civil Komodo find anything against about that?
Hi, I'm Amy again from Independent Media. I just have two questions, please. The one is, I don't know if you saw our story last week on Skywood, but next week they owe 30 million rand. They're not your only affiliate that's basically drowning in financial hardship. I mean, COSATU is obviously not in the best position either, so you obviously wouldn't be able to get the money. I don't even know if you'd be able to anyway. I mean, are you offering your affiliates any assistance? Are you able to offer them any assistance? I mean, have they been speaking to you at all about it? And then just my last question is on the border report. I mean, the border report fingers Colin Machila throughout. I would just like to know if you have yet considered what you are going to do regarding Colin. Thanks.
Thanks, Pat. I'll take all these questions. Since it's about Kobodo, 2 years now, we're saying that the investigation has not been concluded. What are the aspects? I think we are very specific here in saying the Sizwe Kobodo forensic investigators have done most of its work, except that there are two people that are expected still to appear before Sizwe Kobodo to answer questions on the investigation. That is the VMS, Mr. Green, and Comrade Zweli. So this is my father. They have been sent, in terms of the report, numerous emails requesting them to appear to respond to questions. They have declined. They have refused. Now, when the report was tabled in the CC, it left those two people, having not been questioned or at least responded to questions that would have been posed to them. Now, the CC then said we should, because what they presented, they said it's a draft report. Then the CC said we should allow, as NOPs, we must write to Comrade Zweli and ask him to go and appear before the forensic investigators, so that when we sit in the special CC, the report then becomes a concluded report, because in terms of the terms of reference, they have worked on all terms of reference. There's nothing that has not been touched except to interview the two people that have been refusing to appear in front of them. And I think we must also say that in the meeting of the National Office Bearers of COSATU before the CC, we did receive, prior to the CC receiving the report, we did receive a report from Sizwe Ntsaluba Kobodo. They came and they presented what they would be presenting in the CC. And we were allowed an opportunity as National Office Bearers to then pose questions of clarity in the report. Indeed, the General Secretary in that meeting disputed not this report, but the first report. And it was agreed in that meeting that if the General Secretary continues to have serious concerns around Sizwe Ntsaluba Kobodo, he must raise it with Sizwe Ntsaluba Kobodo. But two, in relation to this current report, the Sizwe Ntsaluba Kobodo forensic investigator said in that meeting, whilst we will be presenting a report to the CC, we still allow you, Zwelinzima Mavavi, an opportunity to come in front of us before we go to the CC to present what you think we should hear, but also allow us to ask the questions that will be relevant to you. And we must say that the General Secretary was aware that in this CC that have just passed, that report was going to be tabled. And he knew what was in the report. He knew what the report says about him. And he was given an opportunity to go and appear so that if he may present something different, that may then change the conclusions of the investigators. But what was then tabled was short of his input because he has been refusing to appear. So now I'm responding to say that is the part that the CC felt that let us even now still give the General Secretary of COSATU an opportunity by writing to him as National Office Bearers and say, we want you to still appear in front of Sizwe Ntsaluba Kobodo to state your case. And then the report then that we shall adopt as a final report in the special CC will be a true reflection of what would have been found by forensic investigators. Because remember, they work with facts, forensic people. So that is that part. And then on the Limusa,
you want to follow up?
If I could just do a quick follow up, what gives you hope then that if he's not the CEC, he's going to honor any meetings of COSATU? Do you have some optimism that he will at some point come?
Second bite, let's see, follow up.
Yeah. we will continue to have hope because he's still the General Secretary of COSATU, has a responsibility to the Federation in terms of what is expected of him in relation to the Constitution. Now,
can I go to the Sizwe Ntsaluba?
Okay.
Can I just make a follow up in terms of the Sizwe Ntsaluba report? We had a, when the first report was released, we have a press conference with you here. We debated that, we indicated the content of that report, and I think you released it in some of the media. So you know, the media knows that there was a report completed at that time, because you published it. In that report, you asked a question in the press conference. It is not only the GS who has been accused of something in that particular report. The Deputy General Secretary and the Treasurer, there's a section related to them together with the General Secretary of not have informed the register of the company of the decision to sell the building. So you know that particular report. The issue you asked at that time was, why are you not acting on that report? The decision we took later on that thing was that in the intervention of the ANC, the issues of the disciplinary processes related to the other activities, including the forensic report, was deferred to that process. That's why there's been no acting in terms of those particular report. It's because that report was deferred to that particular processes. The same report that is being given up here is going to be in the context of that political intervention will be deferred to that particular issue in terms of how it needed to be processed. Now, so two reports have been completed. There's no outstanding report completed. Two reports has been completed. The second report that was presented on Friday, 2 days ago, the CEC said we must circulate that report to the unions to do one thing first, to determine whether the terms of reference that were given to the auditors have been met. Because when you assess the report, you need to know exactly whether what you ask the auditors to do has been done, not the content. The content is something that people can dispute if they want to. That's what then after the special CEC will come back to them and say, have they done what you asked them to do? And we explained in the previous one was that the auditors did not complete its work because they did not investigate on the contracts. They investigated on the VMS one part in relation to the stepdaughter, but they did not investigate in terms of the contracts by the same company, VMS, and we said they must investigate those particular issues. The auditors told us, they said they can't wait forever because they don't have power to subpoena. They can't summon people. If they ask people to make representation and people refuse, they will try as much as they can, but there will be a point of saying, this report must come to an end, we've done what we can do. And they indicated in the report to say the conclusion we're making is based on the information given to us. And in an event somebody bring new information, we will take that information and infuse in that report, which may change the conclusion we have. But in the absence of people coming forward, they have to conclude their work. And they said now, we have concluded our work, we have drafted, we are waiting for you as a structure and said, have we done our mandate? And if you said we have done our mandate, then they will leave us. They are expensive, so we not want to have auditors all the time. Forensic auditors and those who might be known of them. Sometimes they work like a doctor. They do this, then they tell you something else and said, I have detected some problem.
But I have no mandate.
You may come again. It's up to you because it's your life. If they say there's something wrong that they have not attended to, it's up to you. That's how the forensic auditor also do. They said, we're looking for this and we find something bad, but we didn't go to it because we have no mandate. What are they telling you? You can't ignore, because if you are accounting, then you'll be said, but the auditors give you a warning on something wrong, why you did not go to it. So you end up going to it. But this time we've asked them, please don't tell us anything. We are going to come back on these issues so that we can avoid these issues. The investigation has nothing to, there's no investigation here that says investigate the general secretary. Even the current one, there's no terms of reference that investigate the general secretary. It says investigate the procurement of by the service providers and the termination of other contract by this particular company because of the relation that they have last time. So it may come up and say the general secretary, it may mention other people in that particular report.
Thanks. No problem. On the Limusa, I'll try, I'm not sure whether I understood it
on in relation to those that the unions that went to seek a mandate?
They want those
names. Oh, you want the names? No. We would have written them in the statement if you wanted you to know. Yes. No, the CEC knows. We were in the CEC. We went through a democratic process. It was agreed that we will allow those to go and seek a mandate, and then we shall reconvene. We shall convene a special CEC to then look at that. So we can't give you the names. Otherwise, it would have been here already. There's a reason why we didn't. On what you said, that Comrade Zweli said if Limusa is accepted, it will be the split in COSATU. Well, that's what he believes. That's what he believes. And it's what he believes. It's not what COSATU believes. See, you must be able to separate. COSATU sat here for 3 days. Amongst the agenda items, it was not only Limusa, but Sayed. What COSATU did in dealing with the two applications, we looked into the constitution for what does the constitution say in relation to a union requesting to affiliate. And both unions, the response that is here, it is based on what the constitution provides. So only Musa, surely Limusa is not replacing anyone. Because they did not say in the application that we are applying to COSATU to replace NUMSA. No, they said we are a union of metal workers and we want to find home in COSATU. And what COSATU had to do was not to do anything except to check if Limusa qualifies in terms of the constitution. Having checked all that, the CEC satisfied itself that indeed Limusa meets all the constitutional requirements. In meeting the constitutional requirement, differently from the first one, emergency unions, was that COSATU now does not have metal workers. It's a fact. We don't have a union that organizes metal industry and engineering sector, rubber and tire, call it. We don't have. Now, Limusa meets the requirements of the constitution also based on that, because there is no combat, there is no union that overlaps with it in relation to its scope. Differently from the emergency services union, because the scope overlaps with the two unions already in COSATU. And we have set up a process in dealing with that one. Because then we must talk to those two unions and see, because the constitution says if a union requests to affiliate to COSATU, but there is a union already that exists in that sector which is an affiliate, then that union must then be merged, if we were to put it, with the current union in that sector. So hence we're saying there's a process that we're going to undertake. So indeed, the CEC satisfied itself that Limusa meets all requirements, but we're allowing the two unions, the other unions, to go and seek a mandate, come back, the special CEC will then conclude. The date of the special national congress in July, it is 13 to the 16th, tentatively. Tentatively, it is 13 to the 16th, but you must also remember it is subject to the availability of the hall that you'll be looking for and all those things, but tentatively, it is that date. Yeah, let me take on your call.
Yeah, you see, eNCA, we follow COSATU's constitution. We can't be forced by the media to issue a notice of the special congress outside the constitution. That's why you're not getting that answer very clearly. But internally, COSATU knows there is a date following COSATU's constitution. The notice will be issued in time when that special national congress in July will be taking place. Matumo, my background question counts at this point, but this is the response. The financial constraints, you're making a mistake, and it's the mistake that again the media repeatedly advanced or made when you people were saying the president of COSATU says we can't hold a special congress because of financial constraints, when we have said it clearly to yourselves here in this boardroom that the one-third of COSATU's unions have a right to request a special national congress, and the CEC observes and respects that right. But in discussing that, the CEC would have said, President, as you consider the request, do take note of four areas: the timing of the congress, the affordability of the congress, the venue, and the agenda of the congress. Now, media then decided conveniently to pick one issue and say the president of COSATU says the congress is refusing to convene or convene the special congress because of financial situations. So it's a long answer to your question. That would have never been an issue even before, which is why last year, not in 2015, last year in November, the president of COSATU announced the date for the Special National Congress in the CEC, the date that Babu Mugambi wants to know. As early as last year in the CEC, that date is known. All COSATU unions are aware of that date, which is why the DGS say the lawyers of NUMSA acknowledge that all what they want us to do, which we refuse to do, they want us to issue the notice now outside the Constitution of the Federation. We refuse to do so. We will issue the date following the Constitution of COSATU. The political levy, this is a constitutional matter, and it's a Congress matter of COSATU. There is no change that can be effected on the political levy in between Congress, so it's remaining. That money is not only used for the ANC programs. Actually, let's clarify this thing again, because people believe that we take money and give it to the ANC. One day I said to you here, the ANC is more moneyed than COSATU. It cannot be that COSATU can take money and donate it to the ANC. We run programs to support and campaign for the ANC during elections and other programs. We use that money for those programs of COSATU in support of the ANC. Two, that money is used to support our youth. Go to SASCO, go to COSAS, go to the Chrisani Institute. So it's not just the money that is used for the ANC. So we'll continue to use that money for those purposes, and until the Congress can say otherwise. Again, the question seems to be informed by a default background about when you raise the issue of the purchase of the building. And as a reason of the situation you are facing, I said in the earlier response, COSATU has entered into a number of contracts with different services that on different services that are being provided here. I did not even speak about the building, you inserting the issue of the building. But the point I was making is that the today's situation we are facing, see, this comes from the results of the forensic reports or investigations that have been conducted.
by COSATU, not in different times. Once, COSATU took a decision in 2013, February CEC, to institute administrative investigations that would include forensic investigation on the purchase and sale of COSATU buildings, but also on the contracts. It also took decision to say, let's investigate how things have gone with Kopano Kimahla and the report of the FSB. That was a decision taken in one meeting, and the processes to deal with those have been going on. Peggy has articulated that quite clearly, that the FSB and the first aspect of the purchase and sale was concluded in 2014, and the report was given here, and what was outstanding was the one that was presented today. So it's not a case which has been advanced in public. It's not a case of they started here and could not find a thing. They have moved to this one because they could not find something. Now they are here because they are persecuting me. It's not that. And I wish you could understand that very, very clearly. It's one decision on all these matters in one meeting, and the conclusion is now in this last CEC, which presented the last leg of those forensic investigations. It's not a witch hunt, but I hope that is crystal clear for the media and workers and people out there. So I couldn't really grasp why the issue of the credit card comes in this discussion, because there is no question about the credit card usage in the forensic reports that we're dealing with. If you have been told about that, that will be wrong. The issue of the credit card, if you look into the 9 charges our GS is facing, it is there. That issue is there. And that's not what we are discussing today. Amy has raised a critical question again. You know, Amy, I had to be angry when I read your article and we communicated, because my sense was that the story there needed to be balanced properly, and speak also to COSATU about the situation there. When you are raising very critical point about the difficulties our unions are going through, and when it could then be rounded up to be saying COSATU unions, then COSATU must say something about that, because we can then speak in detail about the example you mentioning on Sakau, which COSATU for the past 11 years or 10 years, every time we're working with Sakau and the FSB on this matter, which has culminated into a court or constitutional court ruling in favor of an administrator against the union of COSATU, with these costs that are so much, which it's a very painful thing if we don't manage it properly. It really puts the union in a very, very bad light, together with other unions. So my point is, we are working hard to assist the COSATU unions. We may not be assisting them with money, because we may not have the money to help them, but to help each other to go through this problem. Sakau, unfortunately, at the moment, has taken a position that they are outside the Federation. The sooner Sakau comes back and get us to focus on these matters, I'm not promising, but I think you shall then be able to say COSATU indeed is working with Sakau to face this challenge. It's so huge. 30 million or 20 million is not peanuts. It can sink an organization. So we are there. You talk about the other unions, we are there. Sakau, SIPAU, we're spending time with that union to assist it to go through the challenges they are facing. So I think that helps. You're asking a very critical question about the former CEO of Kopano Kimahla. the former CEO of Kopanoki Mahla, who is calling Machila. Look, there is an FSB report, and the FSB, seeing no action followed by COSATU or Kopanoki Mahla on the findings they had made, decided to register a case with the police, and still there was no action. You see, that was in 2012. And we discussed this matter. We want a report. Where is this FSB thing? Where is this FSB thing? There is no answer. And then we decide when the opportunity came for a forensic investigation. We took that report, which we had but did not act on it for a long time. We took it to the forensic people. And indeed, the forensic people had confirmed that should we had acted in time on what the FSB report says, it would have been better. So we tried to do that. After the forensic people had given us that response, we begin a process of engaging with the CEO, Colin Machila. We have a run around, chicken and he runs. Until he resigns, he goes to ESCOM. We follow him, he still runs. Today he's still running. Because we want to deal with this matter that has been raised in the forensic. All what we want to know from him, what is your account of what is in this report? So that we can see how we're fixing this matter. Because it's very critical. Workers or pensioners somewhere in the land, and it is raised in the same report, do not have their pension benefits. It's not COSATU. But if it is accusing a COSATU investment company, surely the CEO that is in charge has got to account. Now people will exploit the fact that COSATU is busy with this and that and so-called tensions and infights. At the same time, they want to take cover of that. All I can say, you can run, but you'll never hide. He has to give an account of this. It's one of the things why in this situation, we can tell you now. But he has to account together with the chairperson there, because the report indeed does show that there's been no governance structures in the organization. So I can only stop there, Amy. It's a matter that concerns COSATU so deeply. We hope that Colin will make himself available and Machila. We cannot subpoena, we cannot arrest, we don't have those powers, but we want him to give an account on what is in this report by the FSB.
What is that we are denying in that report? The mere fact that they are related to COSATU worries us. Whether they have done something wrong, they are different from the issue of the criminal charges that FSB is doing. But on the moral ground that this is a COSATU link investment company, we need answers. That's why we are looking to setting up the trustees and do everything possible so that we, at least at the end of the day, we can be able to account. Let me raise these issues of the political. Let me raise these issues of the political levy, so that you understand it in future. The political levy was set up to do three things: to support the party, to support Chris Hani, and to support May Day. The total amount of money raised annually on the political fund is 4.5 million. ANC is not a beneficiary in whatever way in the political levy. It's not there. And the political levy is not coming from subscriptions.
Mm.
It's not the money that we get from subscription and separate in there. It's a political donation by unions. And there are COSATU unions who have indicated they find it politically, they can't donate on a political
fund.
It's separate from the fund that we raise when we do general election, which is the dealing with the issue that we may be supporting a political party. So please, let's understand these things about 4.5. Is divided into three: Chris Hani, SACP, and the May Day. So it has nothing to do with these issues. Maduma, there's no COSATU decision that an ordinary Congress would be in September. Because you keep raising this thing, there will be two Congresses. In our statement, we say the date of a national Congress will be determined in the special CEC. When we come back from the special CEC, ask us then, when the decision was taken, the president announced it in last year. We hope they infected it in their own budget, because they know now there will be a special national Congress.
Yeah, sure.
Okay, thank you all very much. I see a lot of you starting to leave. I'm sure the office bears will be happy to talk to you later today. And thank you very much.
Mm-hmm.